Hello and welcome to Trusted Review's 2019 Tech Roundup, where we're going to discuss some of the biggest milestone events to happen this year. But it'll be a little different to what we did a few months ago with our awards, where we actually went through gadgets. You can see a breakdown of that at the end of the video. Instead, it's going to be by some interesting categories. And to kick the topic off, we're going to go through the biggest tech disappointments. Big topic, Jade. What are you going to kick us off with?
We'll start with a downer. I guess from my neck of the woods, it's anything ranging from Google Stadia to stuff like Anthem or Crackdown 3.
Yeah, you really hate Stadia, don't you?
Me and Ryan are both. I don't hate Stadia. I feel like I just don't like it very much.
See, I gave it an alright review.
Like 7, was it?
7 out of 10.
Are you a Stadia fanboy?
Since Ryan. The launch, I've gone a bit more pessimistic because new information has come out since. And like they promised all these features immediately after launch, and that hasn't happened.
Yeah, it doesn't even work on Chrome at the moment, does it?
It works on Chrome, but you don't get 4K, even though you're paying for a 4K subscription.
It sounds terrible, but you have touched on something that is actually my biggest disappointment, which is Disney Plus. Why the hell is it? It's so bad.
It's annoying.
That's why I'm disappointed.
Oh, fair enough.
It's like they've got Baby Yoda, they've got all this stuff I want to watch, and it's not even in the UK, but they've done all this marketing.
It's coming.
I've had the Mandalorian. I've had the Star Wars TV show spoiled by Twitter already, and it's not like when I already know who Baby Yoda is.
They could have done something. It's just a real disappointment that they have this really cool service, which according to everybody in the US is actually doing really well. What they got, 20 million subscribers was the last estimate already. It's like, it looks great. It has, like you said, a load of content. Maybe not High School Musical, but a lot of good content. Yeah, I want to see the Mouseketeers.
What's wrong with High School Musical?
Terrible.
Have you seen it?
I've seen like a bit of it.
I've
seen that like Efron doing his like moving things. It looked terrible. It's for kids. I'm too old. I'm in my 30s.
You look a bit like Zac Efron, don't you?
You do actually.
You take that back.
So should we settle on the definitive biggest disappointment?
We haven't mentioned
the biggest disappointment as well. We haven't been able to see the full Huawei this year.
Oh, that's a good point.
Because they've been stripped of having kind of Google services, Google apps on their phones. So Huawei released some really good phones this year.
Some of the best they've ever done.
You can still get the Google stuff on the P30 and P30 Pro, they're really good. But then when the Mate 30 and the Mate 30 Pro came out, these phones kind of just disappeared under the radar because no one wants a phone without Google stuff on it. Though. So, I mean, even though the Mate 30 Pro is a really good phone, kind of one of the phones that I would probably say is one of the better phones of the year, really good camera, lovely screen and stuff. It's not even come to the UK yet. They're not even trying to sell it because I just don't think they want to damage their brand. I think they want to wait and see what kind of, if they kind of are allowed to use these services again, and they're kind of waiting. They don't want to put a phone in here with no Google services.
We've also forgotten about a big product that's been a big disappointment, and that's the Galaxy Fold. At the beginning of this year, we were thinking foldable phones is going to be the new
thing.
That's how
much we've forgotten about them.
I said it then and I'm going to say it now, folding phones are stupid and I don't like them. They just don't make sense as a concept.
I actually agree with you.
I don't agree with you as normal. I used the Fold for a month or so. It's fine. I think that
fine for a £1,000 phone.
Like
£2,000.
It's
So with that in mind, so we can go on to the next topic. Are we agreed? What is the biggest disappointment? You're going to go with, are you sticking to your guns?
I'll go with Stadia.
Yeah, I'm up for that.
Stadia?
Yeah.
I'm going to say, just because I really, really was excited about it, I'm going to have to say Anthem. I'm going to go with you. I think it was just terrible on every level.
Great.
Stadia.
All right, so we've got a very clear thing. Sorry, Google, it's all gone wrong for
you. Stadia might get really good next year.
Yeah, maybe.
It has so much potential, it could get better. Mm-hmm. Most likely it will get better, but we'll have to wait and see.
It's only up from here, right?
Yeah,
it's pretty far down.
If they go down, I don't know what they're going to do.
They'll cancel it, they'll cancel everything else.
Then somebody like GeForce Now, or you know, Project X Cloud will take over and it'll actually be good. But now, going from a low, we're going to go up for high. What is your favorite bit of tech? What is the best tech you've seen this year?
Mine is the camera on the Pixel 4.
Really?
Not the Pixel 4 as a whole, because that phone's already good. But the camera is like really, really good.
Yeah. What about you, Jade?
Having used it for a reasonable amount of time, I'd say my favorite bit of tech in terms of like bringing something forward is the Oculus Quest, because wireless VR eliminates so many of the barriers that people will have.
It's so good. I mean, the Oculus Quest, genuinely, I kind of feel they should have waited, because when I
reviewed,
well, no, this is my point, like with the first gen of Oculus, because when you play with Oculus Quest, that feels like a final product, right?
Yeah.
Whereas whenever you played with even the original Vive or the original Oculus, it still felt like it was a dev kit.
Plugging all of those things in is so frustrating.
Yeah. Facebook's Oculus surprised me, because now we're getting, it's got a demo now, you can use hand tracking without controllers. And also that you can, because obviously the Quest is a standalone headset, it's not as powerful as another headset, can't play certain games. But now it's getting a link, so you can, if you want to, connect it up to a PC gaming rig and play these like games like Skyrim VR, for example, a bit more powerful.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of in agreement. I was actually going to say the Oculus Quest is my sort of, you know, biggest tech item, so I guess that just leaves you.
Yeah, well, I got Oculus Quest as hype for me as well, but...
can't always pick the same one.
I'm going to pick something else, but...
I was going to pick the Switch and you snagged me off.
In terms of laptops, I've been really impressed with the Dell XPS 13. Like, it's out every year, it's always refreshing, so it's not like this amazing new thing. It's just a redefined thing, like small upgrades, but it's still, for me, the best laptop you can get. It's now, like, I went on a board in the office, people looking at it and saying, oh my god, it looks really nice, every just light. It's got Intel's Ice Lake processor. I'm not going to go too in depth for that side of it, but it just means you can play like some Fortnite, Apex Legends, like low level games without the need for a graphics card, and like a small platform thing.
Actually, that does remind me actually of one thing I was going to bring up, which I did get super excited about, which is going to be very geeky, and that was Ryzen 3. This was the first year where when I did my rig upgrade, I was genuinely thinking about going for an AMD build. Don't you judge me.
Yearly rig upgrade.
Hey, don't judge me, all right? I like a higher frames per second count in my games.
Look, I agree. AMD has done really well this year, and like catching up with NVIDIA. Intel and NVIDIA for graphics cards as well. So like, I'm the Ryzen 3 are really good.
So let's go through. I think so far, though, it looks like Oculus Quest was the winner of that round, and that's going to be... has changed their mind after my great argument.
Yeah, I'm not changing to Ryzen. No, the Oculus Quest looks great. I'm not using it, but
Oculus
I'm sure
Quest.
It's really good.
Oculus Quest. All right, guys, so we've agreed on our most exciting bit of tech. So the next one we have is the biggest game changer. Jade, you're up.
I hate that one. You're always picking on me. While it's not coming to full fruition just yet, cloud gaming is a potential game changer going forward. Like, you've had services like Stadia, which we talked about earlier, obviously.
And that's a fair point. On you, Max?
I think it's got to be 5G, isn't it? I mean, kind of 5G has expanded a lot more this year than I expected. And yeah, I think going into next year, it's going to be massive.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to be really boring. And I'm actually going to say AI, which every year that people say it. In fact, I'm going to change my mind. But I'm going to go...
In fact, you were so bored by choosing AI, you actually changed your mind when you were saying AI.
It ties into why I'm changing my mind. But I'm actually going to go for Intel and the fact they're going into the graphics market. So I think the Intel GPUs are going to be a genuine game changer going forward. Basically, they're going to, you know, they're actually making a consumer GPU, which has this really cool modular structure, which has, I haven't really explained it all, but it could be built upon by third parties to make custom like graphics cards the same way that, you know, everybody else does, but on demand, like Dell does with PCs, where you can put the clock speed, the coolers and everything. And they're also talking about making it so like integrated graphics will play AAA games in like a couple of years, which is like, told me that a year ago, I'd have laughed in your face. So that's why I'm going to go with Intel and their GPU.
I'm going to go Foldable Tech.
I'm just going to like piss on that straight away, and I think foldable phones are stupid. It's just like I will say, I am excited by the Surface Duo, like the Microsoft Duo.
So you are excited by foldables?
That's, but I don't think that's a foldable. It's not a foldable.
You tilt all the time.
No, it's not a foldable.
It is. It's a foldable.
Okay, then like the Yoga 360 and like the Yoga, but from Intel, is a foldable.
That's not a screen.
That's on the laptop, mate.
It's got two screens though.
Yeah, I think in a few years you'll eat your words.
I don't think I will. I will say though, I do agree with you on 5G. I think 5G will be a game changer.
Yep, definitely. Yeah.
Just gigabit per second speeds. Even in the little bits of time when I've been testing a 5G phone and had to go to that little special
the little 5G
zone.
Square. Yeah. Yeah,
but it is amazing the signal. You'd like click up on, you just watch an entire season just downloading. It's like, I mean, admittedly, when it happens, the phone usually burns your hand while it's doing it, and the battery dies. But it's still like, whoa. So I'm gonna have to say, I'm gonna do a like joint loyalty and say I actually agree with you two. For my
Hooray, we win.
I'll say those two can pair up.
Excellent. So, brilliant. So now we got the fun one. Biggest villain.
Can you count?
That's just me. Well, for that, you can start. Who is your biggest villain?
Oh, villain. Oh, I don't know. Everyone's been so nice. No, I guess Google's got to be there.
Google?
For Stadia and everything. I'm just like...
I'm really ragging on Stadia.
I feel me.
I like Google. I said the Pixel 4 camera is really good.
That's the only way things will change.
See, I gave Stadia a decent review. Like, I like Stadia, but they just... They came in expecting to, like, beat PlayStation and Xbox straight away, and they've had so many teething issues that I think, yeah, for me.
Okay. I mean, that is fair. You know, going on the vibe, I think you're going to go a different way, and I'm going to say mine. It's the most obvious one. It's Facebook. I'm sorry. If there was a tech company that was a Bond villain, it's Facebook. It's nothing they do is like free. They're not like the like good guys they try and pretend to be.
God, you really like Facebook, don't you?
And Max, it's your turn.
Yeah, I kind of agree with both of those things that you said. I also think that, as kind of I mentioned earlier with kind of the Huawei Google ban, I just think kind of anything involved in that is kind of villainous in kind of an overarching
whichever
narrative.
Yeah.
And you, Jade? Speaking of China, my villain of the year is probably Activision Blizzard.
Okay.
Partly because of some controversy they've had in China, mainly. Like, they banned a player for speaking out in support of, like, the Hong Kong protests, took away his prize money, stopped him from participating in tournaments. And that kind of sparked, like, a lot of outrage over here regarding, like, freedom of speech and, like, Blizzard favoring the interests of China over, like, freedom of speech and players, which has, like, gone down really badly. Like, people have been boycotting their games and boycotting the company as a whole.
But yeah, I mean, for me, I think all of those are pretty valid, though I'm gonna probably say for the biggest villain, I kind of agree with Jade. I mean, I think that's the most direct, like, you know, they actually did something wrong. Yeah. Right, so now we have a bit of an interesting one, the biggest non-event in tech. Mm. I'm gonna be controversial and I'm gonna say the Galaxy S11. So S10, sorry. I'm already in 2020
mode. You've been the pre-brief already.
Yeah, I jumped into the future using Intel
and
graphics.
Break the embargo.
No, for me it was a Galaxy S10. I think it's a really good phone, really interesting, but it was just more of the same from Samsung. You had the Galaxy Fold and Galaxy S10 5G, which is cool, but it just felt with a vanilla, normal phone. They just were, you know, going through the paces. There was nothing interesting about it.
So yeah, I would kind of say just flagship phones in general have kind of been a little bit disappointing this year. Hopefully that means that 2020 will be kind of the big upgrade year where there'll be loads of new stuff, and that will be the year where all these kind of new interesting things kind of finally take off.
Cool. And for you, Jade?
I'd say E3.
Really?
It was my first E3 to be there in person, and a lot of people around me were going, oh, it's quiet this year. Because it was, because Sony wasn't there. Microsoft had outsourced their presence to a theater down the road. But obviously you had big games there that we're all excited for, like Cyberpunk, Final Fantasy VII, and teasers of the next generation. But it very much felt like a year where people are holding their guns back for next year.
Yeah.
Where things are gonna go completely balls to the wall in terms of announcements.
Right. Mine, the movie swing along, probably thinking about it.
Cut the crap, let's get this going.
Ray tracing, basically. So
okay.
I know it's a bit nerdy.
The nice
so Max isn't like nerdy stuff.
Hey, don't judge us.
But late last year, 2018, NVIDIA released a RTX graphics card, but they're really expensive, and NVIDIA haven't really, I think they seem to switch back to their HD cards to make a big push out of those, because their RTX cards aren't something as well as they hoped for. So it will be really good in the future, but for now, I don't think it's quite there, and it kind of been a bit underwhelming, I'd say.
Totally.
Let's do a vote. So you're going to go with ray tracing.
No, I'm going to agree with Max about smartphones.
Smartphones? Jade, what are you going to go with?
I'll go smartphones, yeah.
Okay, well, my vote doesn't matter then, so.
It really does.
Right, and now we're going to go on to our final category, and probably the most important, what we're most excited about for next year.
Yeah, mine kind of covers next year, but also years kind of going forward. Mine is much better ways of streaming football. And now Amazon have kind of come in, and they showed an entire kind of evening worth of games. You could flick through the games on the app. They were, some of them were in 4K HDR, they looked really nice. And it just felt like this is how we should kind of be watching football. You could watch it without the commentary on. You could kind of watch the highlights as they were happening. Yeah, it feels like looking at the future of how we might kind of be streaming football in the future.
Can't wait to see Jordan Henderson lift a Premier League trophy in 4K.
Oh yeah,
I'm not going to lie to you, the motivation kicky ball, I started thinking about penguins, so moving on. Jade, what's yours?
The obvious answer would be the new consoles coming, launching in November, like we discussed
earlier. So you think the updates are going to be small?
I think the jump in specs will be quite significant, but I think we've reached a point of visual fidelity in games where we can't get much better beyond like ray tracing and like smaller details.
That's why they're promoting it. If you hear about what PlayStation Next was talking about, they're not talking about these amazing new graphics. They're kind of focusing on stuff like SSD speeds, what basically eliminates
it's
loading
faster.
Screens.
Do you think that that will be an easy sell to a customer? Like, oh, it loads faster. Whereas kind of PS3 to PS4, like this looks pretty amazing.
I think the biggest sell this year.
Harder selling something to someone saying, oh, I might load up a bit quicker.
I think backwards compatibility is going to be the biggest sell.
Okay.
I think if you can log into PS5 on day one and have all your digital games ready to download.
I can do all that on my PS4 already.
Yeah.
But it will look PS4 nicer. Games on that.
Yeah, I think as well, like, you know, the whole thing with it is everybody, no matter, as you said, I think console gamers aren't necessarily as technical as, you know, PC gamers, but I do think that if they market it right, and if they have a really good launch lineup and a load of exclusives, which we know Sony is very good at, people will jump just so they can play the latest games. I mean, Last of Us 2, whenever you guys talk about it, you two talk about it, your faces light up.
I'm going to write my 10 out of 10 now.
Yeah.
And are they going to come in at prices similar to what the PS4 was? Obviously, that was pretty good value when it came out. Are they going to be able to get this new ray tracing, high-end SSDs into consoles and to keep them
at
a price?
I'm going to go $399.
You, Ryan, what are you most excited about?
I've mentioned them quite a lot this time, but like the Surface foldables, I think, look really good. Obviously with computing stuff, you don't really find out about stuff until fairly short after. It's not like a console when you find out 3 years before. So I'm looking forward to like new innovations for laptop-wise. But what obviously Microsoft wants to say early on about the foldable tablet and the foldable kind of phone, like for me, paired with streaming, like another good thing I can't wait for is like xCloud and GeForce Now. If they can pair that together, then that kind of basically changes gaming. And
I mean, really that goes, I would agree with you there, and that's why for me the most thing I'm excited about is actually PC gaming and what's going to happen.
It always is.
Come on, it's great. We've already talked about a lot. We have fundamental changes to the graphics community, and you know, technology is coming in. So ray tracing is going to be standard. They're going to be more affordable because it'll be second generation of cards. Intel, AMD, Intel, Nvidia, things are heating up. Yep. All the companies now are in competition and really have to come out guns blazing to differentiate themselves. So I reckon they are all going to have something special up their sleeves.
I think 4K monitors is finally going to become more affordable. So then, like,
I love 4K monitors, and also, for gamers who don't want to monitor, there are now TVs with proper 120Hz refresh rates and things like that, so you can game on it. And then on top of that, given everything else that's going on, I do think that even if you're talking about PC gaming, not in the sense of building a rig, streaming and 5G will impact the PC gaming market. Yep. More and more people will be able to take things like a Surface and it just becomes a portal if things like xCloud and Stadia start working properly. I think that's going to be a really good year, basically, for PC gaming. I'm really excited to see what all the companies have for components, but also what services are going to be brought out and developed.
Cool.
Yeah.
Hype.
So we're going to go through a vote. Ryan, what's your vote?
PS5. And Xbox 2.
Yeah, me too.
I'm going to stick with what I said.
So am I, but that leaves you as winners.
We win.
So that's pretty much it. So we've actually gone through all of our top topics, which is exciting. Right, guys, that's it from us. Thank you very much for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed the roundup. And if you stay tuned, you're going to get a roundup of the best gadgets from the Trusted Reviews Awards. Thank you.